What's up, everybody? Welcome to Self-Helpless. I'm Delaney Fisher.
I'm Kelsey Cook.
And I'm Taylor Tomlinson.
And oh my gosh, do we have a show today. I am so excited to have this guest here. We have Fred Rosser here. Whee! Professional wrestler. Yay! Yes, sir.
We did it, everybody. Yeah. We did it.
We did it. We've made it. WWE champion, superstar, former tag team champion. Hopefully I'm not messing this up too bad.
No, you're doing, so far you're doing a great job.
But you're just overall badass. We're so lucky to have you. And you are the first, in wrestling history, first openly gay wrestler. Which, holy shit, that's amazing. Yeah. Thank you for being here. And I guess since coming out, you've been really involved in the LGBTQ community with charity work, working with Covenant House, which helps homeless teens, the Trevor Project in Los Angeles, which helps with LGBTQ teen suicide prevention. So you've done a lot of amazing things, and we cannot wait to dive in and ask you all the questions.
Wow, you've done your homework.
Type A up in here.
Yes,
a lot of reading.
So first of all, so what is this?
You have a large brown liquid jug with you.
Yes.
Well, it's not alcohol, let's just say that. August will be 1 year that I haven't drunk.
Wow. Congratulations.
August will be 1 year that I've been in L.A. from Tampa, Florida. I've been here full time. And I stopped drinking because I just wanted to bring that to L.A. Right here is my BCAAs and glutamine. I don't cramp up. I can't be cramping up here.
You're like speaking Chinese when you say that. What does that mean?
BCAAs and glutamine are...
And be sure to talk into...
Powdery substance that... help me not cramp up and keep me moving.
What does BCA stand for?
Branched chain amino acids.
Okay.
So,
all right.
Yeah.
And what's the other thing?
Glutamine. Muscle recovery. It's just like drinking juice. I go about a gallon and a half, 2 gallons a day.
Two gallons a day?
Wow. So how many hours a day are you working out?
Power hour, baby. Power hour. I'm not in the gym. Bunny hopping 2.5 hours. I'm in there an hour, in and out. I keep it moving.
And then the rest of the day you're just peeing after 2 gallons of that.
I sweat like puddles in the gym, literally puddles all over the floor.
Oh my god!
And I like to stay covered up because I'm a germaphobe. I don't like my skin touching the machines, so I stay covered up.
Working out in scrubs.
I mean, pretty much. I stay covered up. I mean, I don't like to touch the machines or anything because of germs.
So. Wow. So when you were wrestling and you were touching other people,
how did that work?
Were you
I
anxious?
Would freak out.
Well, I mean, we all take care of our bodies. We shower. It's a proper etiquette to do that. But with the machines, no one wipes down the machines properly. So
people get MRSA so easily there, right? Like I've been so freaked out.
I don't
about
know.
That.
I've never had it. So I don't know what that is.
Yeah. And so MRSA is like the really intense staph infection that can kill people, and it comes so easily in gyms because everybody's sweat's going out on it, and nobody's like wiping shit down.
In the wrestling industry, it does come, you know, but you just gotta, you know, take care of yourself.
Yeah.
Even on airplanes, I'm a frequent flyer. Even on airplanes, when I get on, I have my Lysol spray and I spray down the...
Good man,
where we put our forearms.
Yes.
Oh, I love that. I'm going to start doing that.
That is smart. Yeah. They fly a lot for, you know, touring purposes.
Yeah, I mean, me personally, you know, so... Mm-hmm. And I always wear hoodies over my head because I always... somehow sit behind someone that just sneezes and like it hit you. You know it hit you. So I always wear a hoodie, so if you're gonna sneeze, just sneeze.
Let it fly, man. Oh, sneeze guard. I love it.
It is what it is, but that's like from traveling for the last 10 years straight every week because we're a traveling circus. We're professional stuntmen, and what we do is entertainment, but we do get hurt. It comes with the territory.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Do you have any other things that you figured out just traveling as much as you do that makes traveling easier for you, being gone all the time, how you take care of yourself, getting enough sleep? Because we talk about that a lot, being comedians, we're gone every weekend, that we're still figuring it out.
Yeah, and trying to eat healthy on the road.
And we're not in as amazing shape as you are. Yeah. So any tips you have would be incredible.
No, you women look great. This is my first...
I love
this is my first podcast with all women.
Really?
I've never done a podcast with any women. They've been all males, and to have three of you guys here is pretty cool to help me tell my story.
Yeah, welcome.
The first professional wrestler
on here.
And
first for everybody.
And I always say there's room for everyone at the finish line. So, like, however I can help you with your platform and vice versa. So,
Okay, honestly. Can we make that a quote? Stop.
Quote. There's room for everyone at the finish line.
Stop.
Okay, so I know this might be embarrassing, but I actually screenshotted some of your quotes from my friend Farbo, who wrote a beautiful article about you. You said some incredible stuff I would like to share with our listeners.
For the record, we usually ask the guests to give up, and we'll ask you what your favorite quotes are.
Yes.
But that we have you here, and you have amazing quotes, and you just said one off the fly. You're perfect.
For everyone at the finish line.
That's amazing. That's so inclusive and beautiful. And in the entertainment industry, which we're all in, it's so competitive.
Everybody's cut their leg off 4 feet behind you.
I mean, there's so much content out there. Content. I mean, why not help each other out, especially in crazy times like this?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Let's get some quotes in here. Yeah, hopefully this isn't too weird for you.
One of my favorite quotes that you said. I love this. Without commitment, you'll never start. But most importantly, without consistency, you'll never finish.
Yes.
That's so good.
I love it because I got it from Denzel Washington.
Oh, you did?
I got it from him. So it's something that is very meaningful to me. It's something I always say in a lot of my speaking engagements. Without commitment, you'll never start. But most importantly, without consistency, you'll never finish. Mm. And like from 2002 to 2009, I grinded to get that big spot with WWE.
Yeah.
I was doing shows in front of 20 people with no shower and no toilet. I've wrestled in front of 20 people to 20,000 people. I had the door shut in my face so many times from 2002 to 2009. And 2009, I had 75 guys and girls from all over the world in Tampa, Florida. I did my last and final tryout with WWE, and I beat them all out. I was a maniac for 4 days. And this was when you had to pay to try out, you know, like, you have to pay to maybe be on a show. Like, I've done all that. I've been a ticket seller. I've done all that. So I've grinded. Wow. So 2009 was a time when I had to pay to try out, and I used $2,000 of my own money to do this tryout. And if I didn't get picked up, I most likely would have been a firefighter or in the police force.
Oh my gosh.
But I wasn't. I was scooping ice cream from like 11th grade.
Goddamn, hottest ice cream scooper ever.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Yo, I would eat a lot of ice cream. I'd just be hanging out there a lot. No. Hi, it's me again.
Yeah.
Don't get it twisted. I was a heavy kid growing up. So,
really?
Yeah. So 11th grade, I was working at Dairy Queen and doing what I had to do. I was managing the store. I was good friends, good Jewish family. I loved them to death. They helped me do my own schedule, and anytime I got a tryout or a show that I needed to do, they always relieved me. So
that's
why I worked there.
Okay.
And they were more than just my boss; they were family. I grew up with their kids, and I'm just very happy to have had those opportunities to do my tryouts and do my wrestling on the weekends. So I definitely thank them.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You are so grounded and humble. It's like you have such a wonderful energy, and just listen. I can't. We're
just
going
to said that my
compliment you off.
I guess my sign is my year's a pig. I was born the pig year. Are you guys familiar with the horoscope? Like, one of my friends told me that the characteristics of a pig are like someone that is very grounded and
interesting.
Like, I don't know
the year thing. We've talked before about horoscopes just with like the different signs, but
years. And I'm a Scorpio, so I'm very
me too.
Yes.
Boom.
I'm an introvert, but I can socialize as an extrovert. Like, once I'm done, like, with you guys, I'm just going to just sit and just, like...
be done.
We feel the same way. So you talked a lot about getting the door slammed in your face over and over again. How did you handle that rejection? What made you keep going?
this is something I've always wanted to do since a little kid. My dad and I don't really talk, but he was always there for me. When I was a kid, he always had a hot meal on the table for me. Mm-hmm. He got me into wrestling. He was a fan himself. He took me to a lot of the shows. I spoke about him in a People magazine. His picture was featured, so he was very happy about that.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, so he's always been there for me, so I don't like to hide that.
Yeah.
So it's something I've always wanted to do. I would play football. I would play I would amateur wrestle, and I would just do it just to, like, maybe hit someone late on the football field, and they would be like, bro, what are you doing? Then I would just body slam them. It would always end up in a wrestling match, and everyone knew that this was something I wanted to do. And in my yearbook, one of my last sentences was, WWF, here I come. I was gonna do it.
Oh my gosh.
And it's all about playing your cards right. I mean, let's face it, this entertainment business can be cutthroat.
Yeah.
So you just gotta play your cards right. And why I lasted so many years in WWE was because I'm a guy that I can work with anybody, you know?
Yeah.
I like to highlight your strengths and hide your weaknesses. That's just the way it is. Live TV, you gotta be ready.
Yeah.
With WWE television, we're the best improvers in the business.
We
got to learn how to read a script, or we got to know how to improvise. So
aside, whose line is it anyway?
Like,
you got nothing.
With me, I work on bullet points. I just like to go back and forth and just get to the point of the subject.
Wow. So you knew you wanted to be a professional wrestler, like, as a kid. So what was that moment like when you did it? Like, when you got that call, you're now part of the WWE. This is your lifelong dream.
Yeah.
What does that feel like? Because that's where we're all striving for that like phone call or that feeling that, like, I've made it. I set out to do this thing.
Yeah.
Well, now it's here.
Well, back in the day, WWF didn't have a drug policy. WWE now has a tough drug policy because we've had a lot of deaths in the company. So the first thing they asked me was if I was clean of steroids. I said, yes, sir. The last time I've ever taken an enhancement supplement was December 2008.
Mm.
And it's just something, it is what it is. I think all professional athletes might have done it, but I'm not afraid to admit it. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't do it again ever, because I was young and dumb in college, rooming with baseball players, and it's just something that you're around your environment.
Yeah.
You want to get that edge. Some of the best in our business were beasts.
Yeah, it's like spray tans for baseball. Yeah. we gotta step it up.
So the business now is clean. So yeah. I said I'm off all enhancement supplements. I'm ready to get signed. And I moved down from New Jersey, where I'm born and raised, all the way down to Tampa, Florida. And that's when I grinded, because once you get down there, you're amongst maybe 100 people in developmental. So we're split up into classes, but there are 100 people in the industry that are trying to make it to a select number of spots on TV.
Yeah.
So it's very cutthroat. So like, sometimes you have some good dance partners and not so good dance partners in the ring, and some things might not go as well. Some people might mess up on purpose, you know, like, man, what? I mean, it is what it is. But
that's why we like stand up, not improv.
I've always been a guy.
Just us.
I've never had issues like that. I've always been a guy where, like, I'm making you look good. That's what my job is. If we're going to have a performance, you know, where you and I are fighting, I'm going to make you look like $1 million bucks. And I'm going to make it look like, you know,
nice,
where I slip on a banana peel and that's it for me. And then that's when you're going for the kill. I'm going to make you look like $1 million bucks, because that's entertainment. You know, people wouldn't expect that. People would expect me to beat on a woman. But let me slip on a banana peel and, oh, man, now you're on top of me.
My turn.
Yeah. Now so that's entertainment. That's fun for me. I'm about telling the story.
Wow.
So, everyone loves working with me. You ask anyone on the roster, if you ever meet anyone, John Cena, anybody, you ask them, and they'll tell you that, you know, I'm a good, what they call it, utility guy. But I'm more than just that.
Yeah.
I'm someone that, you know, is fighting for the LGBT youth as we speak.
Yeah.
So I always say my fight is much more bigger than in the ring. It's outside of the ring, fighting bigotry and hatred.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Can you tell us about coming out and your story and how it happened and if you were worried about coming out in this sport?
I was closeted for 30 years. 30 years of my life. So I came out probably 2 years to my immediate family, my mom, my best friend Trouble in New York, and a few other people. I call him Trouble because we wrestled together on a minor league level. His name was Tommy Trouble. So he's a straight guy, always loved me, still does. So I told my immediate family, because I was in a relationship with a female for almost 2 years that I met in Tampa, Florida. And she was a beautiful girl, wonderful girl, into fitness. She never did anything wrong to me. Yeah. I was just like living a lie, and I knew I was living a lie. And after a while, enough was enough. And I told her the news, and she wasn't happy.
Yeah.
But then she realized that she wanted to understand. She wanted to know more, but I was at a point where I was like, just leave me alone. Don't talk to me. And I was young.
Yeah.
I was young. So now if I could maybe talk to her and be friends, that would be wonderful. But I'm just grinding away. But when I came out to WWE publicly, I didn't think at the time it was major. But when someone like Cher reached out to me, on social media and said, man, because of your story, I'm very happy that you came out, because one of my friends who's a big wrestling fan came out to his family. So thank you for doing what you do. So it was that moment when I came out and she responded to me like that. I was like, man, my story's a big fucking deal.
Yeah, wow, what
big
an impact.
Deal.
Yeah.
Big deal.
And you came out to TMZ? Is that
came out to TMZ.
Wow, just thinking nothing of it.
Yeah.
Just like, this is who I am. I'm not going to.
I've been approached by TMZ several times, and this was at a time when we didn't have a relationship with TMZ. Everything was just like, hey, it is what it is. And now I could have been outed, who knows? Mm-hmm. But I said what I said, and I was happy with what I said. But when I got back to my hotel that same night, I was sick as a dog. I'm like, man, why did I say that? I was like, maybe I shouldn't have said that, because I don't know how it's going to be perceived.
Yeah.
It's like the fear of the unknown.
Right. Yeah.
So it's just like, man. So I immediately contacted WWE. I said, hey, this is what happened. I said what I said. And at the time, they supported me. And when the news broke, top superstars embraced me with love. And guys like Randy Orton, Big Show, Mark Henry. Mark Henry is the world's strongest man on WWE television. And he's one guy that when I first got brought up to the roster, he said, because at the time I had spiky hair and I had gold sequences around my head, and he's sitting back in the locker room and he said, boy, why you got your hair like that? It makes you look gay. And this was before I had came out.
Oh, man.
And I said, I was nervous. I said, Mark, man, I'm sorry, man. I'm just trying to look different. This is in the locker room.
Wow,
and he had said that, and I was stuttering over my words. And I said, Mark, I'm just trying to look different. And I wasn't out. And fast forward to when I came out to TMZ, he was one of the first guys to, you know, wrap his arms around me. And he said, when he writes a book, the chapter of one of his one of his selections is going to be insert foot in mouth, because he felt like a idiot for saying what he said, not knowing that I wasn't out. So it was guys like him and a few of the top guys that really embraced me with open arms, would always involve me in locker room banter. And there's some guys that maybe just didn't like my lifestyle. It is what it is. Or they didn't maybe want to lose to a gay guy. My thing is, gay comes in all sizes and shapes. Not everyone is feminine. I'm very masculine looking. I get hit on a lot.
I'd imagine.
Yeah.
I'm trying not to.
I know. I'm sorry. I already did.
Everybody's refraining.
Listen. Thank God I'm out to the world, because I don't have to hide. I was just on a family vacation in Tampa, Florida, and I was sitting by the pool, not bothering anyone, you know? I had my headphones in, and then this little black girl came up to me, and she was like, oh, my sister wants to know, are you with anyone right now? And the girl was probably like 8 or 9 years old. Yeah. I said, tell your sister that I'm gay.
Oh my God.
I just said it out loud, and she swam back, I guess, over to her sister. And now I can say that. I'm comfortable saying that.
Yeah.
I don't have to hide and be like, yeah, my wife's in, or my girlfriend's right. in the hotel room. I don't have to hide. I can just be honest, open with myself and have fun with it, you know?
Yeah.
I'm not afraid anymore to just like do like all that.
You know?
Just to throw people off, you know? Just to throw people off, like, man, you know, because even at the gym, when I work out very hard, and I do a lot of unique stuff that's safe, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of functional stuff. So people are looking at me, and like a lot of straight guys are looking at me, and
What do you do? Like safety wise?
Oh no, they're like, man, that guy's in good shape. Like,
oh, okay.
You know, yeah. and to me, I get turned on by it, because only if you yeah. knew, honey. You know, sometimes I give them the eye, like, and they wouldn't expect that. You know, God. they just turn the other way. I don't give a shit anymore.
That is awesome.
You
know?
Yeah, you're not gonna kick my ass. You're not gonna kick my ass. Absolutely not.
I hope we can like take this footage, and when you just gave that look, zoom in.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
I love
my
that.
Goodness.
Wait, yes, which sir. Camera?
You got one? Either one. You got all of them.
You get a good look, honey. I don't care anymore. My management team might be a little upset that I act like that. I don't care. I'm just able to be myself.
Yeah.
You know? I don't act. The way I act is the way I act. I would do interviews before I came out. Listen, my name is Bone Crusher Fred Sampson. Let me tell you one thing.
Oh,
I would
God.
Cut promos like this to make myself sound more masculine. I don't have to do that anymore.
Wow.
I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Wow.
So now I can talk like this. I don't have to talk, hey, ladies, how you doing? It's great to be here.
So that's how you were talking in the WWE.
Yeah. Well, not in WWE. This is how we talk on the independents, like to grind in on the independents, you know?
Okay.
And like... Who knows if I would have made it if I was out and about, but I was the first openly gay WWE superstar to come out publicly. And there have been people in our industry, and a lot of closed-minded people don't get it. There have been people in our industry that were gay, but they weren't out publicly. So I came out publicly to the world, and with social media, it just blew up.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I always say right now my fight's much more bigger than in the ring. It's outside of the ring, fighting bigotry and hatred and trying to be the voice of the voiceless for the LGBT community. The LGBT community so desperately needs a LGBT superhero, and I'm going to be that guy.
Oh,
so
love it.
Why not have a LGBT superhero, Black Panther-ish
type
in the world?
Yeah, have other wrestlers come out since you've come out, or
more wrestlers on the independent level,
okay.
the minor league level,
wow.
and again, they got to play their cards right. And you know, if you can play, you can play. So just if you have talent, and there is some talent, this one particular kid in LA, his name is Jake Atlas, and he's got a lot of potential. My story inspired him. Good looking kid. Good looking Mexican, and I think he can definitely do it. He's got a lot of potential, and I hope he makes it in the industry. Again, we need more representation. I'm 34, not 24. Michael Jordan, I'm not saying I'm Michael Jordan, but Michael Jordan can't play basketball forever. So,
right.
But again, I still have a lot left in the tank.
Yeah. Right.
I'm 34, I can go a few more years. Right now, I'm just doing it for fun.
Yeah.
Quality over quantity. I'm not trying to whore myself in this world.
Yeah.
So I want to be a novelty. I want to do certain things, and I'm glad I can do that.
Yeah, that's and because awesome. You came out after you had already made it, you're making it easier for people who are on the come up to come up before they even make it big.
Why not?
That's so cool.
Gratitude fucking reciprocates.
Yes.
There's another one.
Oh,
so many good quotes.
I got that from Matthew McConaughey.
Attractive men you're taking close to my life, and I see what's happening here.
I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I'm just letting you know who I got it from.
I love it.
I like who inspires you. They inspire me too.
This is like a little bit off topic, but I just watched the Andre the Giant documentary on HBO. Have you seen that yet?
No, I'm sorry, I've not seen it.
Oh my gosh.
I want to see it though, but yeah, I've been so busy, but
no need to apologize. That's like us, you know, people ask us, oh, did you see that person's comedy special? We're like, no, we're fucking performing comedy.
Yeah,
we don't have time to watch other people. So I totally get it. Was he a big influence for you at all? I know that he was probably later, right?
Yeah, he was way later, back in the 80s. But yeah, he's a guy that wrestled Hulk Hogan. Someone that I really looked up to growing up.
Yeah.
And he was Andre the Giant. He was a giant in our industry. He, he passed away maybe in 93 or 94.
Right.
But yeah, he's an OG.
Yeah.
He's an OG.
Who was your biggest inspiration? Was it Hulk Hogan?
Hulk Hogan, Shawn Michaels, Ricky the Dragon, Steamboat. These are just, you know, I mean, Hulk Hogan would probably be the most recognizable name.
Yeah.
But yeah, like guys like Shawn Michaels and Ricky Steamboat were mentors of mine, especially Ricky Steamboat, because why I loved Ricky Steamboat, he had a way of selling to the people like he was injured, he was hurt, he was in jeopardy. And then when that bad guy would slip on a banana peel, then that's when Ricky Steamboat would be that Superman, fiery guy in the ring. And I really enjoyed him. I really enjoyed watching him. So I'm trying to illustrate to you, trying to paint a picture, use wrestling terms to kind of help you out.
Tell you
why I like this particular person.
Yeah.
So all these guys were believable.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. So you said earlier, sorry for jumping around a little bit. Oh. You said earlier you were an overweight kid.
Yeah, I was an overweight kid and I had a speech impediment.
And you had a speech impediment. Wow. What did you, what was it, a lisp or something?
It was a, not a lisp, but certain words I couldn't pronounce, or certain letters I couldn't pronounce. But I was in speech class for elementary school, maybe fourth grade, fifth grade.
So was I at a lisp growing up. Yeah.
So eventually I overcame it with a speech pathologist, and sometimes it comes and goes, but I'm not as bad as I was when I was a kid. So I tell these kids, and even adults, that I had these issues, but I didn't let it hold me down. And it helps. It helps for people to hear the story.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's gosh. Yeah. Looking at you now, I mean, and there's any kid would be like, I can do anything. I could be that.
God, yeah.
I could be at house. That's just when did you start getting into fitness?
Well,
when did you start really?
I was overweight because I don't know about your grandparents, but both my grandparents lived right next door to each other. Oh. So after school, 4 o'clock, I would go to one grandparent's house, probably watch Oprah when Oprah was on. Oprah was on prime time, right? Or a date or evening
like
time.
4 p.m.
Oprah was on, so I would eat at one grandparent's house, and I would go to the second grandparent's
first
house.
Second
6:30, I'd go to the second grandparent. Then I would go home and have my meal that I always said my dad always had a hot meal on the table for me. So after a while, I just blew up. So I was a heavy kid, but everyone loved me. I always beat up the bullies and stuff like that. But I was a class clown, and I got involved with student government because of one teacher that said, you know, you would be a good role model for the class. So I did that for like 3 years. Maybe junior, senior, and freshman year of college. I was just heavily involved. And then that wrestling thing came up when I found a school that was about 30 minutes from me, from Union in West Paterson, New Jersey. I trained in a garage from 2002 to 2009, and that's when I got my chance. But I grinded.
I grinded.
And I picked up so quickly.
I think I read about, do you have like an organization called Block the Hate, or is there kind of some movement? Do you want to tell us about that?
Sure, yeah. The Block the Hate movement originally started with me being the first openly gay WWE superstar, but it's more than just an LGBT movement. It's a movement for anybody that gets bullied for various reasons. You might get bullied because you have a speech impediment. I might get bullied because I was an overweight kid. You might get bullied because you had freckles or whatever.
Right.
You know? But in order
to
be
scared for a second, I was like, "What's he gonna find on me?"
I don't know. I don't want to offend anyone. I'm just
freckles
talking.
Is a good one. Good question. Good job. I was like, "Freckles, you? Could you feel my body melt after?" I was like, "Okay." Felt like I was getting the Terminator scan for a second. I was like, please God, don't say something I'm very insecure about. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God.
Beautiful breasts.
I know. Scared.
One of my favorite comedians, and Chelsea Lately. I love her.
Oh, Chelsea Lately, yeah.
Yeah, I just love her, love her. I think she's so funny, and I just love, and when I came out publicly, my boyfriend had, at the time, had caught a clip. No, he had said that, oh, Chelsea Handler had said something about you. And she said, when she was doing her rundown, she said, oh, WWE superstar comes out of the closet. Typical black guy with an Asian. And I was cracking up. You know,
oh
I was cracking
God.
up. I thought it was amazing. I've never met her before, but I always wanted to meet her.
Fan, yeah.
Huge
that's
fan.
So, and that's cool.
Like, she's just so down to earth. There's this one female announcer, commentator with WWE. Her name is Renee Young, and she is like, she makes me feel so comfortable with interviews. She's so cool, and she reminds me of Chelsea.
Yeah.
Just amazing. Just amazing. But
sorry.
Yeah.
So the block the hate. So yeah. Whatever it is, freckles, whatever.
Yeah. Oh, you're also getting bullied.
In order to be strong and successful, you got to block the hate, and that's what it's all about. So it's a universal movement that I want to be the next middle finger. You know, you say I can't do it. Well, fuck you. Block the hate.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It's actually the equality sign I'm wearing my shirt.
Oh, nice. Oh, that's really cool.
It's actually the equality sign with my forearms and hashtag block the hate on the wristband. Now, the T-shirt is just a byproduct. You know, it is what it is. But it's more than just a T-shirt. It's a movement that we so desperately need now. People always reach out to me on social media almost every day with a story, or if it's a legit fan, and I've had one legit fan actually think about commit suicide, and he wrote out a big message. I video direct messaged him. You know how you can like send videos? So I told him, you know, hey man, you know, just cut it out. And I lended my advice. You know, I'm not a counselor, but I mean, I can just be a friend. That's all I can be.
Yeah.
I can just speak from the heart. I'm no doctor, but I can just speak from experience and just give help where help is needed. And he talked himself out of it. And I take stuff like that seriously, especially when it's a fan that you've had dialogue with and that you've met. And when you travel a lot, like this fan is in the Midwest and he's struggling. So whatever.
You've met him.
Yeah,
on
I had
the
met
road.
Him. So I knew it was serious. You know, people don't joke around like that. So I was able to help him out, and that's what it's all about. My fight's much more bigger than in the ring.
Yeah.
No one's perfect here. Yeah. I mean, we all have our dirty little secrets. You know, just keep it real. You know.
Yeah.
But I'm not out to hurt anyone. I'm out to be loving and caring and have fun, because life is too short. Life is too short. It is what it is.
Yeah. So what would you say right now, because we have a lot of listeners and maybe somebody is struggling to come out to their friends or family, what would you say to that person after being, you know, in the closet, I guess, for 30 years, you said, right? And then coming
out. Well, yeah, like 28 years. I think I came out when I was 30.
Wow.
So like 28, whatever.
So what would you say to them, and like the biggest differences with, you know, being open and not, and your experience with that?
Come out when you're ready, you know. No one should hold a gun to your head like, come out. I came out when I was ready. I was tired of, with my boyfriend at the time, he's one of the reasons why I came out, because I wanted to be able to bring him to wrestling functions with me. So him and I started dating Nick Villa, 2012. I met him in Miami, and we were together almost 5 years.
Wow.
Deep into our relationship, I wanted to come out eventually, because I was tired of being affectionate behind closed doors. And then when I come out in public, where I'm like just like walking like we're bros and stuff like that. So I was just tired of living that way. I wanted to be able to bring him to wrestling functions and have him experience what I experienced. Because there came a time when, and I'm sorry I'm going off subject.
No, this is great.
It is what it is.
What we like to talk about. Yeah.
You know, this is serious shit that I want people to hear.
Yeah.
I wanted to be able to bring him to wrestling functions with me, and I wanted him to be able to see the life that I live, because there came a point when, I guess, friends were in his ear saying, maybe I'm messing around on the road and stuff like that. And I was completely, honestly loyal to him.
Yeah.
So I said, oh yeah? So is that how it is? I brought him on the road with me plenty of times. We're up at 5 a.m. for a flight. Boom. Flight to the venue. We land. We go to the gym. We eat. We go to the venue. We perform. We drive 300 miles. It's go.
There's no time to mess around.
Yeah.
I mean, it is what it
you're
is.
You're tired, too.
Yeah, you're like, I barely have time to be with you.
Yes. Guys do what they do. it is what it is. But me, I was faithful. I was loyal. After I'm done with the show and we can leave, I'm going to the next city. I'm looking at how much time it's going to take. I'm cruising, listening to my music. I'm going, maybe talking to him.
Yeah.
Cruising to the next city. I'm not messing around. When I'm committed, I'm committed.
And what did he do?
At the time, he was doing fine dining restaurant. And he's still doing fine dining restaurant. And I respected him for doing that. But, you know, there came a time when, like, he could sing, dance, he could vlog, he could do whatever. And I wanted to help him out. And all that stuff was his hobby, but it wasn't his passion. Fashion was passion. So eventually we broke up, not on bad terms. And, and I'll explain why. And I believe in September he's going to be going to the fashion school in the UK. He got accepted.
Oh, cool.
He moved back home from Miami to Chicago, where we used to live, to raise the funds on his own. Oh, so wow. I'm very proud of him for doing that. So he'll be going to school in September to follow his passion, to get his master's in that.
But you guys just felt like you were on different paths?
Different paths. But the one thing I tell people in a lot of my speaking engagements, and I'll tell you now, the one thing I learned from him was to talk it out. You know, us guys can be, you know, keep our feelings in and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then I can just explode like that.
Yeah.
So I learned from him to talk stuff out.
Yeah.
If there's a problem financially, there's never a problem financially or anything. If there's a problem with anything, talk it out. And that's something I learned from him. And he still helps me out to this day with a lot of my speaking points when I'm speaking to the LGBT community, because he's just good with his words. You know, me, I'm just like, so I need help. I need help. And he was good with his words. He helped me explain, like, a situation like transgender bathrooms. You know, that's a tough subject to talk about. But at the end of the day, everyone should be safe.
Yeah.
So everyone should be safe when it comes to that issue. And not pick a side, you know. That's just how I work. Not pick a side. I like to just be straight and down to the point.
Yeah.
You know, everyone deserves to be safe.
Yeah. Period. You know? Yeah.
So when you two started dating, he was out to everybody in his life.
Yes, he was out, but he was, man, he was amazing, and he's still amazing. But he was out. He came out. His family disowned him for a little bit.
Oh,
but they're doing great. They're doing great now.
Yeah.
But he was young when he came out, so he was gay and proud, and I wasn't. And I wanted to be happy at the end of the day. And I got an opportunity to do Ellen when I came out, and she was wonderful to us. And one of the last things that Nikki said in the interview with Ellen was, his happiness is my happiness. So he's very happy that I'm happy, and I was happy that I was able to bring him to speaking engagements and to bring him, hold his hand at a WWE function, Hall of Fame, you know?
Aww, that's amazing.
And be proud. And, you know, you have your people on social media. Cyberbullying is one of the most serious forms of bullying. You know, it is what it is, whether you're, you know, a young kid on social media or an adult. You know, sometimes the shit hurts, you know, like, man, why are these people saying this? They don't even know me.
Yeah.
And then you'll get some people, because I'm very good at reading, like, hey, man, it's nice to meet you. You know, you're not so bad after all. I'm like, what?
Yeah, I mean, it's the backhanded compliments.
Yeah.
What do you think you're doing? Do you like me or not? Just be straight. If you don't like me, just say it.
Yeah.
People are gross.
Internet trolls. Yeah. Terrible.
Yeah.
So has it been hard being in the limelight? I mean, like, you're on.
Hey, baby,
you know,
this is what I signed up for.
Right.
This is what we signed up for.
Was
like,
it like, okay, I'm in. I'm all in. Or has it been like, oh, man, I didn't know it would be like this?
No, I mean, at the end of the day, my happiness is more important than anything. You know, I'm 34, not 24.
Yeah.
I made it in an industry that is a tough industry. It's a it's a tough industry to be in. It's very cutthroat. You got to play your cards right, like I said. But I'm happy to be able to be myself, because if you're not yourself, it's unfortunate. You can do some harm to yourself, and I don't want to do that to myself, and I don't want anyone else to harm themselves.
Yeah.
So it's a serious issue when it comes to bullying.
Yeah.
So
was your team, so like your reps, were they supportive of you coming out, or were they a little bit like, ooh, damage control at first?
Right.
Is that look again? He's like, what the hell do you think?
I mean, right. It was convenient when it was convenient for them.
Right.
Like I said, I always talk about the people that supported me, the superstars that supported me that were my friends.
Yeah.
I always talk highly of that, highly of them.
Yeah.
I don't throw anyone under the bus. Vince McMahon, the owner of the company, is an amazing person. He gave me one of my last TV opportunities with them. He gave me a shot to do a gimmick on television, and I believed in it. He believed in it. It's just unfortunate the people that work under him, you know, had their own agenda and had their own people that they wanted to get up on the roster.
Yeah.
Because I was a Vince McMahon guy. I wasn't a Triple H guy or any of those people.
Yeah.
Vince McMahon gave me my opportunity, and I'm very happy of it.
Yeah.
I have no hard feelings. I always say, if you need me to come back to do a speaking engagement or whoop someone's ass, I'm available.
Know where to find me.
But life's too short. At 24, I would have probably, when me and my boyfriend separated, I could have threw him under the bus. When I got released from WWE, I could have threw them under the bus. But I had a wonderful career in WWE. The one thing that really upset me was this past year, one of their biggest shows of the year, WrestleMania, they had LGBTQ representation on the show, and they haven't ever done that with me. So it kind of hurt me when I got released from my contract last year, which I'm not, like, Michael Jordan can't play forever, like
I
said.
Yeah.
So I was released from my contract, which was cool, you know? A couple months later, there's this LGBTQ representation on TV that is done by a straight man.
Oh, God.
I was...
What?
That
Let's
is
call
not
the petition.
That is bullshit.
That's
yes,
crazy.
That is bullshit.
I don't, so, were you, it was a surprise that you were released, right? You were like, what? It did not see it coming.
I didn't see it coming. I was doing media with them for a... what game was it, Farbod?
The Clipper game.
Yeah, the Clipper game. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. You guys get me all riled up. but Clipper game. And I did social media for them, and the next day, this was a Saturday, and Sunday morning, I'm just sitting in bed, and I get a call from talent relations, and I answer the phone. Like, it was like 11 a.m., and the guy released me. And I was like, it is what it is. I'm sure maybe someday I would come back. Who knows? But I'm okay with being released. But a couple months later, when you see this representation, I'm like, oh, man, it kind of hurt, man.
Yeah.
And I made it vocal on social media. I was
good, yeah.
And I told people, I cried like a baby when I seen that. A grown man like me, I cried like a baby. Like, when I seen this representation, I'm like, man, couldn't you have, like, invited me? Like, kind of invite me and just say, hey, you know, Darren, Fred, whatever the hell they want to call me. Hey, check this out that we're doing, you know? And I would have loved to have shown up and just have felt it and seen it. But I'm like, man, not even an invite or anything to just see the moves that we're making. Because I love the guy that they put it on, Finn Balor. I love him. He's a great guy. And they have another LGBT representation, lesbian, Sonya Deville, who I'm really good friends with. So there's representation on her end, and my boy, Finn Balor's repping the LGBT colors. That's great.
But he's straight?
Yeah, he's straight.
It's, that should have been you.
Yeah, that makes no sense.
It is what it is, but just maybe invite me, you know? I just want to be able to feel the crowd and rah, 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 and stuff like that. But I was even invited, so that hurt the most. So and I made it known, like...
Good.
I made it known. I cried like a baby.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
I'm so sorry.
It's like when Scarlett Jo got cast to play an Asian woman. It's like, what are we doing?
Transgender.
Well, recently,
Scarlett, she just stepped out of it because of all the backlash from like the transgender community being like, we're right here. We've been trying to get these roles, and now you make a role and you... cast somebody who's not?
Oh,
like,
I didn't even know about that one.
Oh, yeah.
I was like talking about when she played an Asian chick.
No, she's, she's deep in it.
She's deep in it. She keeps getting cast for things.
Go home, ScarJo.
Yeah.
You have enough money.
Yeah.
You are white.
Yeah.
We get it. You can do anything.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's why I always say there's room for everyone at the finish line, people. Come on. Let's work together. Give people an opportunity.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Holy crap, that's, yeah, I have, do you guys have other...
I know, I'm trying to keep an eye on time.
We've got another,
I don't
like,
too much of your time.
Five to 7 minutes,
okay,
something like that.
Great. Is there, what do you want to plug, you know, all the organizations you're involved in, everything, where to find you, all your social media?
My social media, Instagram and Twitter, at RealFredRosser. Mm-hmm. I have RealFredRosser.com. You can see where I'm performing at, where I'm speaking at. Again, the Block the Hate movement. The shirt is just a byproduct, but if you want to join the movement, you can go to blockdate.com.
It's a very cool shirt.
Yeah, thank you. Everyone loves the colors. I wear it in the airport. People are always staring and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I mean, but I'm
probably staring for a couple reasons.
Hey, honey, why hide hard work?
Cool shirt.
Hide hard work? Why not?
You know?
Yeah,
love it.
I love it. That's so good.
And I've partnered with a clothing brand that's based out of Sherman Oaks who, I've been friends with them 2 years. They're a great organization, a great clothing streetwear company that I believe in. Their message, they treat me like family and the quality of the clothes. And the owner of Headquarters Clothing, Pedram's a big wrestling fan, so I met him through wrestling. And it's a brand that I believe in. And the Block the Hate movement and Headquarters Clothing, our messages are parallel to one another. Having to do with success, Headquarters Clothing, where's your headquarters? Where do you achieve success? Mm. We achieve success in the entertainment field. So it's about embracing it and knowing your headquarters. So it's a brand I believe in, and you can follow them on Instagram at HQ Clothing, or you can go to headquartersclothing.com and check out their apparel. So I moved out to LA. It'll be a year in August, making moves.
Awesome.
In acting, commercials, telling my story with you guys. So I found out about this opportunity and this hookup, I said, why not tell my story?
Yeah.
If I can tell my story to a committed, loyal audience, why not?
Yeah.
Why not?
Do you like LA? Do you like it so far?
I love it. I love it. I love the atmosphere. The traffic can be a little chaotic, but you just got to leave early, baby. I was here on time. I'm in and out, you know. I don't like to be late for anything. The music, I'm an R&B head, so I'm always listening to my R&B. I turn it up, and I tune out all the beep and the horn. I don't speed anymore.
Yeah.
This is my first move to LA. I was driving my truck into one of those small garages, and like I hit the side of my car rushing. I said, forget that. I'm stopping rushing. Stop it. Stop it.
Yeah.
When the light is turning yellow, I stop.
Yeah.
I don't care because sometimes – you know, anything can happen. I've seen it, you know.
Yeah.
LA drivers are aggressive.
Yeah.
So you might see me in a truck driving like Miss Daisy.
Yeah, right.
I don't care. You can flip me off. I'm just driving.
I've got D'Angelo playing. Yeah, yeah. Fine.
Well,
I need you.
I love those guys, D'Angelo, Monica, and all those R&B singers. But I'm a big fan of the up and comers because I started from the bottom too. So I'm listening to people like Daily.
Okay.
Please. Look them up.
Okay.
Daily, Jeremy Passion. That's just my vibe. What do you guys listen to?
Oh, gosh. We talked about this in the car. We just went to Vegas and we were talking about it in the car about how like anxiety inducing it is, talking about what kind of music you like. Kelsey made a great playlist for Vegas.
Oh, yeah. I love music. And I feel like I got pretty good taste in music.
Yeah.
But yeah, I listen to D'Angelo all the time. Solange's new or like the most recent one. I really love that one.
Yes.
Alicia Keys.
Yes.
That's like some of my favorite writing music because it's just so like chill and nice.
Yeah.
So I love that. Big Tenacious D fan.
Yeah. Tenacious D, Jack Black and Kyle Gass. Love me some Tenacious D.
Oh, I mean, there's a time and a place for everything.
Taylor's like an 85-year-old
man.
She
looks like
classical.
Barbra Streisand.
My mom's a big fan.
Album.
That's not what I said.
My mom's a big Barbra Streisand fan. Big.
I'm like, I get sad and put on Frank Sinatra and try not to think about him hitting people.
Oh, God.
You know how it is. you were such a good... Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you.
You were so lovely.
No, please let me know how everything goes, and I'd love to come back. I'd love to actually have my mom on because I didn't tell anyone. My mom's also gay, too. So she's like my ride or die chick. So she's 56, but she looks like she's like 36. So anytime she's in town, she lives in New Jersey. She loves the weather here, but she doesn't want to live here. Mm. So anytime she visits, she's like my ride or die chick. Anytime that I'm forced to be in a bar type situation, yeah, I always have her with me because she's like my second eyes. Like, mom, who's looking at me?
Oh my God.
Is he looking at me?
Oh my God. You know? Please stop. Don't make everyone fall in love with me all at once.
She's always been gay. She came out to me when I was like maybe 9 years old, but I didn't come out to her until I was older because at the time I didn't think, she always talked about wanting kids. I can't wait to have grandchildren. Aww. So at the time I'm like, a man and a man, not knowing, you know, and years later there's science that can help now.
Yeah.
My uncle who, and again, I mean, there's so much to talk about, but my mom being gay, she's always been gay. She's always been supportive of me when I came out, but I never came out to her because of fear of her not being able to have kids.
Wow.
So,
wow.
Yeah.
But, heavy stuff.
Yeah. So
a lot of pressure.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of pressure. Yeah. So yeah, my mom's like, she actually lived out here in LA mm-hmm. back in the '80s. Mm-hmm. Because she moved back 6 months because she was a failed comedian. But she's more funnier now than she's ever been. And like, awesome. And I tell everybody that about my mom. I say, yeah, you know, my mom's out here 6 months, and because she'll say, yeah, Sonny, I was out here 6 months, and like, it just got too expensive. I just couldn't take it anymore. So she went back home, but she's funnier now than she's ever been. So like, anytime I can involve her in my social media, she is as raw as they come.
Yeah.
Rated R Robin Rosser is her name. That's what I'm trying to involve her. I don't know if we can get something going because she's sitting in her prime now.
Yeah. Like, she's so close to New York. Why didn't she do stand up in New York? It's the best place to do it.
I think reality TV is probably just best for her.
Seriously. Yeah. Are you pitching that? You should be pitching a reality show with your mom.
Maybe I'm working on it, but she would write her jokes on her hand. That's what she told me. And I've seen videos. That's why you failed if you got to write your jokes on your hand, you know? She was like this.
That's your problem.
I'm like, fuck, mom. That's why she was a failed comedian, writing her jokes on her fucking hand.
Oh, my God.
But, yeah, you know, but again, if I can come back and have her, like, she won't be camera shy. She'll let loose.
You have to pitch a show with you and your mom.
I'm working on it. Maybe someone watching this has a hookup. You never know.
If anyone listening has a hookup.
Reach out.
Yeah.
Boom. Yep.
I just want to plug our sponsor really quick.
Yes.
Vented in Brooklyn. We love you so much. Again, aromatherapy bracelets. If you buy one, they donate one to a cancer patient to alleviate chemotherapy symptoms. They donate to all kinds of cancer organizations. You can go to ventedinbrooklyn.com. Enter the code VENTEDSHP15 for 15% off your entire order. And they have all kinds of cool designs and power words on there, like grateful and fuck it and all kinds of cool shit.
I know. We're so excited to get our fuck it bracelets.
Check them out. We love you guys so much. And thank you, Fred.
Yes, you're wonderful. So nice to meet you.
Real life Superman.
You really are.
Hey, baby, I'm working on it.
Love it. All right, guys.
We'll talk to you next time. Bye.
Oh man, thank you so much.